Okay, welcome to this session on FDP201x. I am in RC1005, Anna University, and there are about 20 excited people sitting in front of me. So to begin, now what all of you have done so far is, you know, you have done the flipped classroom activity, you have done the TPS constructor, you are doing the OER creation and all of that. So in this session, what we will try to see is, how can we sustain such activities. So the main goal that we want to now look at is how to sustain such activities. So building and sustaining collaborative communities, because as many of you would have experienced that these are somewhat new ideas. So unless we form a community, not just within one college, but across colleges, it is required for us to keep up the enthusiasm and keep trying these new active learning strategies, learner-centric strategies and so on. So this is what we are seeing here on the slide is very famous levels of engineering education practice slide. So what this does, so this is from a 2012 reference, and what it defines are these 5 levels of engineering education. So level 1 is at the bottom and level 5 is at the top. Okay, so what we will do is we will just go through these levels and try to understand where we are, where we want to reach, how to get there and so on. So if you look at level 1, which is the normal teaching, what is called as normal teaching. Okay, so the basic idea here is we teach as taught. Okay, so what do we mean by teach as taught? I mean the way we learned, we went to classes and we had instructors who come and gave lectures, and that was sort of like the 20th century teaching, where the emphasis was on the knowledge that was available to the instructor, and the idea was to transfer as much of the knowledge as possible to the student, and all the practice was being done by the student later on. So that was the teach as taught level, which is the most basic level. I mean, anybody starts often at that level of teaching the way we have been taught. Then once we improve a little bit, what we do is we go to this level of what is called effective teaching. So how we do in effective teaching is that we teach using accepted practices. So what are some of these accepted practices? Well-known practices like what we have been learning, TPS, peer instruction, giving assignments to students and all of that. Okay, and then once we say that, okay, I am implementing these approaches, this is a very common query that we get, is that, oh, all these activities are fine, but in our college, if the noise level becomes very high, then the other classes get disturbed, and principal says, what is going on in your class and so on. Okay, so how do we counteract such things? The way to counteract is by doing these experiments. So you do some experiment, very simple experiments, not a very elaborate or complicated experiment. So you are saying that, okay, I will teach one class using TPS, I will teach one class without using TPS, I will teach one class using TPS, I will teach one class without using TPS. So you just alternate. This is called a alternate or ABAB design. So and then you see, okay, how much learning is happening in one class, how much learning is happening in the other class. So alternately, when you see, it's a very simple experiment that you can conduct, and then you will have data to show that my students are actually performing better when I teach them using these active learning strategies. Does that make sense? Yeah. So that is when you start engaging in educational experiments. Now again, one person cannot do all the experiments. So in your college, if you have to convince 50 other colleagues to adopt such practices, you can't do all the experiments. So the way to do it is that each of you do one experiment in your own college, and then we collaborate and we share the results so that the results become available to everybody. So some of you may have heard of this conference that we run called T4E, Technology for Education, right? So again, in that, many of the one entire track we have in that conference, so this year we are not running, but T4E 2018 will be in IIT Madras, and so in that, again, there is entire track which is devoted to sharing of such experiences, that okay, I tried TPS in my class, this is what I found, and so that others can also become, can access these experiences and implement them in their own colleges. So now what you need to do this, what do you require in order to be able to operate at this level? So we are saying that we are moving above teaching using accepted practices. Okay. So when we came into the course, maybe some people were as teachers taught, but everybody moved out of that level very quickly. Okay. So everybody is at least at this level of saying that we are going to teach using accepted practices. And now we are saying that, okay, I want to operate in this level where I am doing these experiments and all. How do we do that? So how do we do that? Is one is we need to do regular practice, right? Often I get this question as to, you know, how many active learning practices should I do in each class? Okay. So it depends upon how long your class is and all. So, but at least one active learning activity in every session that you take is a good idea. So that is the regular practice point. Then there is support from the community, which is what we are talking about. We will create a community, like you would have participated in the wiki creation activity. You are participating in the OER creation activity. What we will also be doing later on, not immediately, later on we will create working groups which are, you know, domain based, and we will try to say that, look, let's get a lot of ECE instructors together, a lot of computer science instructors together, so that together they form the community to not only share and contribute OER, but also to share this knowledge of how to do the teaching. We cannot keep conducting these workshops again and again. We need large number of people who are now able to conduct these workshops, right? So this is what we want. We need mechanisms to refine these. So there has to be some mechanism of peer review, right? I mean, it's not like I created an OER and I put it up, make it available, and you know, that becomes the standard. So there has to be a process by which it is reviewed by at least 2-3 people who are in that discipline, who are able to say that, yeah, this is actually a good OER, it can be used, and so on. Okay. So how are we going to do this after the FDP? So this some of it Jay Krishnan will also be talking about later, but in order to get support from the community, we are having this notion of cohorts. So we've already formed cohorts and on a remote center basis, and we will try to create activities which will keep these cohorts going on. Then there are platforms to share and contribute. Oh yes, you are all now familiar with it, right? I mean, everybody has done the RCS of creating these web pages, contributing to wikis, participating in the Padlet activities and all that, right? And when we are doing a refinement of the OER, we have to do some peer review mechanism in order to refine these OERs. Okay, so once again to summarize, where we are is that we are now saying that, okay, I want to assess my teaching and make improvements, and I want to start engaging in educational experiments. So in order to do that, we have all these mechanisms of practice and sharing the resources into the OER and then refining the OER itself. Okay. So then what to do if you want to go even further, if you want to get to level 5. Okay. So level 5, what happens is you are conducting educational research, publishing in journals. Okay. So like, for example, the activity, like the model that we have come up with for conducting this MOOC itself. Okay, so this model that we are using is called the Attain, Align, Integrate model. Okay, so this is part of Jay Krishnan's PhD thesis. Okay, then the LEDs, LBDs, all these ideas that you have now become familiar with, right? I mean, so how should an LED be created? So coming up with ideas like that, so that's when you get to level 5, where you start creating more research. You start saying that, okay, how can I use this in teaching? You don't stop with simply using it in your classroom. You don't stop with simply doing experiments to show its effectiveness. So there are two things, right? I mean, let's say a new technology comes tomorrow. I mean, none of what we have heard beyond Padlets, beyond all of these things, some new technology. Okay, let's say, take any example. Huh? So now one thing, the first thing that you can do is you will play with the technology. Okay, you will try to see what I can do. The second thing you will do is you will try to use it in your classroom. You will create something to use in your classroom, right? After that, what you do? After that, you say, okay, I'll do some experiment to see whether it is useful actually. No, I believe it is useful. Now I have to go beyond belief. I have to see whether it is actually making a difference. So you will do some assessment. You will make some improvement. Then you will do some experiment in your more formal experiment with some control group, some experimental group, and you will try to see whether this new technology, the way I am using, is it useful or not, right? Is that enough? Okay, it should be known to others. I make it available to others as part of OER. Still, is that enough? So there is one more step. So that last step is what we are talking about now. So the one more step is that, now let's say you have done it in computer science in your topic of data structures and so on. Okay. Now I happen to be a chemical engineering teacher doing something else. How can I use this idea for my course? So that is the last step, where from the experiment that you have performed, you now abstract it out. You take it one level above and you create some guideline, you create some model by which others can do it for their subject. Okay, so like for example, the LEDs that you have seen. So we have talked about how LEDs have to be created, right? In November, we are going to start a MOOC on how to create MOOCs, how to use MOOCs in your teaching, right? So the way you will say is that it's not enough for you to just simply watch this LED, how to create that LED itself. Now, what are the principles to follow? So suppose you are using a new technology, you come up with principles. You say that, okay, for any topic you want to create use of this technology, do steps 1, 2, 3 and 4. So that way, the knowledge not only propagates to larger people, it also becomes usable by larger amount of people. Otherwise, what happens is, I see that, okay, you have done something in computer science, you have used that. And as another instructor, I may feel, oh yeah, all that works in computer science, it is not going to work in my discipline. You know, often people stop there. So you take it one level up. So that is what is meant by this conducting educational research and publishing in journals. Journals, conferences, even conference like T4E is a good venue. Okay, so how are we going to support this? So from our side, you know, there are a lot of video resources we have created. So there was an IST workshop on research methods in education technology. Some of you may have attended it. I mean, we did this a couple of years, maybe 2-3 years ago. What we are going to do is in 2018, January 2018, we are going to run this again in a MOOC format. So that will run as ET601, 602TX or one of those numbers. Okay. So you can conduct action research on your own, and then, you know, hopefully, so in January we will run the course on, you know, so in this course you have learned these new techniques. Now you have time to implement those techniques in your classroom. In January, we will say, okay, how to conduct a formal study using these techniques. And then July will be the time when the T4E deadline will come. So hopefully many of you will be writing papers for T4E using the knowledge that you have got in these FDPs. So this one, the next one, which is a MOOC on MOOC, how to create MOOCs. And then the third one, which is on how to do research in education technology. And then hopefully in July, you know, we will see a lot of you participating in the T4E conference, not just as participants. Many of you may have come as participants, but we are hoping that more and more of you will come as authors. Okay. The other thing that we are doing is that we have this teacher use of education technology research group. So this is in our IIT Bombay education technology. So if you just Google IIT Bombay educational technology, it will take you to our department website. And so we have two major projects. One major project is on one is for students and one is for teachers. So very simply looking, that's the way it is. So the students project is about, you know, how to teach students skills which are useful beyond that subject. Okay. So often it happens, right? Our students, you know, they are not interested in our subject because they want to go and do something else, right? So instead of wasting the time trying to teach them what they don't want to learn, we are trying to see, okay, what is it in that subject that is broadly useful. So these are what we are calling as pan domain thinking skills, and we are creating systems by which teachers can use that in their laboratories and so on. So that is one project. Okay, so that is technology enhanced learning of thinking skills. And the other project that we have is this teacher use of education technology, that is like how teachers like you can not only get to know about new educational technologies, get to incorporate them in your courses, but also do research based on that. Okay. So you can be a participant in a research study. Like for example, somebody has come up with, let's say I have come up with a TPS activity for data structures. Okay. You may also be teaching data structures in a different college. So you and I can together say that, okay, let us see whether the results that I get in my college are the same as the results that you get in your college, because these are all human subjects, right? They are not like, you cannot say that it's a computer simulation or something, that when the program runs each time it is going to give you the same result. So different times you might see different results. So then we'll get a deeper understanding of what is the difference between this college, that college, why it's happening like this here. So in that way, we can have people participating in research studies. We can have people contributing domain examples, right? So a lot of these things, now there are so many of you with, from so many different domains, like we are trying to create a corpus of TPS questions for each domain, right? So, and in each domain there are so many courses. So for each course, if we can create, let's say for each class one, so if you say that, you know, there are about 20-30 TPS examples for one course, right? So we cannot create it sitting in IIT Bombay just by ourselves. So I can only do it for my course. So the courses I teach are programming and networking. So for two courses I can create, I cannot create for the other courses. So that is where you can participate, you can contribute examples for your course. So this is why the OER creation activity was an important activity. So that's how we are going to take it forward. Okay. Then, you know, you can be faculty associates in future workshops and MOOCs. Are any of you faculty associate here? Yeah. So there are like 3-4 of you are already familiar with this model. And I'm sure in the other RCs also the same situation holds. So then slowly you become more and more steeped in this idea of not simply transmitting information, but to use the technology meaningfully so that students learn, right? And finally, you know, we have not yet set up this working group. So this is, you know, it will sound very abstract when I tell you that, you know, what is it to participate in a working group. But we have to do some homework before these working groups become ready. Basically, the idea is that we will somehow try to structure it as multiple domains, different domains, people come together and work. So yeah, for now, see, these first three bullets we are already doing. The fourth one we are working on, maybe by early 2018 we'll have some structure by which you can participate more in these activities. Okay, now so let's hear from a few remote centers, like how many of you are practicing active learning technology integration in your practice. Have you formed a community within your institution? Okay, what difficulties are you facing and so on. So we will do this in a Q&A manner. So there are a couple of questions which I already see in the question panel. So while people are making doing the hand raise, let me look at some of these questions. So I'm not going to answer any of the administrative questions like, you know, what will happen to my marks and things like that. Okay, how to find Creative Commons license for videos? So now this is again, you know, it depends upon the person who is creating. Like we have laid a lot of emphasis on don't create your own content, go and find content, useful content and so on. Now some of it you may find that they have not specified whether it is free for public use or not. So if people have not specified, the only solution at that time is to, you know, if you can find the email ID of the person, you know, you at least send him a mail saying that, look, I'm going to do this, is that okay with you or not? Typically, but a lot of people have started putting their license on whatever content that we release. Like for example, any PPT that we make now carries one, you know, Creative Commons attribution and you know, free to use and all those kind of licenses. Okay, so there's another question which says, can we change the FC constructor design provided? Okay, so yes, you can. I mean, none of these constructor designs are, you know, they are not like something which is religious. So they are a means to help you to do it easily. So if you feel something is not working for you, you can change. But a lot of thought has gone into creating those constructors. Try to do minimal change. That will be the best. Okay, so then, so same question is being asked again. Can we prepare our own PPT for Flip Classroom? Or only have to fill in the provided constructor? I mean, you can prepare your own PPT, but it's like, you know, you're reinventing. So what will happen is you may wind up making the novice level mistakes that we also made when we started doing all these things. And you know, there's been a lot of learning that has happened after which we came up with the constructors. Now we'll start doing the interaction. So let me start with the local RC. Yes, please go ahead.
What happened was I use a Linux desktop.
Okay.
And in Linux, I was able to download the RCA example file, but it was not proper. It was in PPT, whereas my Linux desktop supports ODT.
Okay.
So the whole thing was not already. So what I did, I went ahead and prepared a different classroom presentation.
Yeah.
So in those cases, maybe
Yeah. So the question is about, you know, if it's a PPT and now I am using ODP and then does it match and, you know, the formats get garbled and all of that. So if it is a question of format, there is no problem at all. I mean, if like one slide doesn't work for you, you want to put it across two slides, that's also fine. But in terms of the thought process that you are going to include, I mean, so how you create the RCA is not so important in terms of the, I mean, you could even write it in a document, right? So it's like the thought process or it's the teaching plan that you are going to have along with that flipped classroom activity. That is the important part. Yeah, RC 1063, Dr. D.Y. Patel Institute.
Sir, my question is, the flipped class has worked very well. But then think, pair and share, is it that many think, pair and share is going to be flipped class? What will be the exact differentiation between TPS activity and flipped class?
The question is, what is the exact difference between TPS activity and flipped class? Okay, so see, the TPS activity is one component of your flipped class. Okay, so the flipped class has many things. You have out of class activity and you have in class activity. So in the in class activity, what you do is the TPS is one of the activities that you do in the in class part of your flipped classroom activity. See, flipped classroom again is not a very new idea, you know, even though we seem to feel that, you know, it has been recently discovered and all that. Flipped classroom idea has been there for a long time in the arts, for example. Like if you take literature as an example, a typical literature class would run as that the teacher will say that, okay, you read this passage and come. And then in the class, the teacher does a discussion, students share their opinions and so on. Okay, so that's nothing but a flipped class, where the teacher is not describing the passage in the classroom. Instead of saying that, okay, we will read this essay or something in the class, the teacher is saying that, okay, you read it at home and then you come prepared for discussing about it in the classroom. So that's the only idea about a flipped classroom. It's not like a very revolutionary new idea which nobody has tried before or anything. So what you do in the in-class part depends upon your topic. So for some topics you may want to do peer instruction, for some topics you may want to do think, pair, share, for other topics you may want to, you know, simply give a quiz, for some other topics you may want students to work in teams. So that in class part is where all these other active learning strategies come in, which is like PI, TPS, team, pair, solo and so on so forth. Okay, so we can go to the next college, BMS College of Engineering.
Sir, we have two questions here. Sir, I had conducted active learning for my course Unix System Programming, wherein what I did is I had given a complex program like shell programming for the students, and I had specified what is expected out of the problem, and later I asked them to join in the lab. I had given 2 days before the problem definition, and 2 days after I took them to the lab, and in a 1 hour duration they had to code that. Finally, I took their implementation and I evaluated. So I have two questions here. One is my approach correct? Can it be called as an active learning? And I had paired the students and they had to implement in pairs. So my question is this a form of active learning? And the second question is, I evaluated like how effective was the problem implementation using marks. And I had also taken the survey feedback, but I had not converted into percentage. So if this is right, can I convert into percentage and will this be a different approach?
Okay, so what she's saying, let me just repeat the point for the benefit of the others. So what she's saying is that when I have a programming type of a course, like in this case it happens to be shell programming, when I have a programming type of a course, I give a programming assignment for students to do and then they will go and carry out that programming exercise in the lab, maybe as pairs and so on. So is that active learning? At a very broad level, the answer is yes, because if you look at the broad definition of active learning, you are saying that, okay, students need to express their thinking, students need to, you know, go beyond simply listening to your lecture and so on. Okay, so the important thing to keep in mind is that in programming, it's very easy to feel that, or in any course which has a lab associated with it, it's very easy to feel that, you know, I am anyway doing active learning because the lab is taking care of the active learning part of it. Okay, but what is a little more useful is if you structure the lab activity also. Like for example, in this case, instead of just asking two students to work together, what you can do is you can have a specific goal. So even in the lab, you can do something like a TPS type of an activity, not a full-fledged TPS, but you can say that, look, each student will work on some portion of the program and then they will discuss with each other. Otherwise, again, what can happen is one student is simply watching while the other student is going on, typing or, who's doing the most of the work. So to summarize the answer, while most of the lab activities do come under active learning, what is useful is to structure these activities a little more using the principles that we know, like peer instruction and peer feedback and so on. The other question was about how to give grades and percentages for that. I really don't know about, that depends upon college to college. It depends upon what is accepted in your institute. So, but I don't see any problem in saying that, okay, I'm going to give some marks and convert these marks into grades for these activities. Sir, I'll just go back to BMS College and see whether this has answered the question and if they have anything else. Yeah.
Sir, one more general question.
Yeah.
I was also the participant last time when we conducted this similar workshop, and this time also we are conducting. Large number of participants are participating in this workshop, but even they are scoring very good marks. Some of them have scored cent marks. Okay. I feel it is limiting only to the certification, and many of them are not implementing it. I think we are not able to motivating them enough to implement there in their classes. Of course, it requires a lot of preparation before we go to the class. I need just your opinion on this.
So, what to do about people are doing it just for certification and not implementing in the class? So if you look at it from our perspective at IIT Bombay, our goal is not 100%. We are not aiming for 100% of the participants to do 100% of what we are trying to disseminate. Okay, so there are various levels. So initially, many people will just be at the awareness level. And all these ideas, they take time to come into mainstream, right? And in education, we have to think in terms of decades as the unit of change. So we cannot think in terms of years as the unit of change. So yes, it is going to take a decade for large number of people to, for this to become very standard practice. So you are the early adopters, right? So you are the ones who have to be the pioneers and say that, okay, I'm going to do this. And maybe one way to do that is, invite speakers from other colleges who have done these things. Like for example, this is a very common thing, right? If somebody in my own college has done it, I don't think it's a big deal, because it's like somebody in my college, what does that fellow know? So that kind of a thing is there, in all colleges. So what we do is, like when we want to propagate something in IIT Madras, so I'll come from IIT Bombay and tell them that, look, we are doing this in IIT Bombay, so all the IIT Madras fellows do. When I want to propagate something in IIT Bombay, I'll call my colleague from IIT Madras to come and give a talk. It's the same talk. I can give that talk also. But if I give the talk, people don't want to listen in my own institute. So I'll call my colleague from a different institute. So you can do the same thing. You can invite your colleague from another institute to come and say that, oh, they are doing that in that college. And then we say that, look, more of us should start doing. And so those kind of activities we can do, right? And overall also, see, there is no problem if people attend the same FDP multiple times. In fact, that is one of the advantages of a MOOC, that the first time, maybe the ideas are so new to some people that it's very daunting to try these things in their class. It's okay. It's like watching a movie, we never hesitate to watch a movie multiple times. So there is no harm in watching the same course also multiple times, going through the same course multiple times. And each time, you build a little more confidence to say that I can do this on my own. I can do this on my own. There are others. You look at the discussion forum, you feel that, okay, if that fellow in that institute can do it, then I can also do it in my institute. So that is the way we have to go at it. So the real test will be after 5 years. So already we have passed one landmark, So this entire T10KT project, when we started, been about more than 5 years now. And the level of interaction that we used to have in the beginning versus the level of interaction that we have nowadays, the type of questions that we get, we are getting very rich and very in-depth questions now. In the beginning, the questions that we used to get from participants used to be fairly superficial. right? Whereas now people are saying, oh, I have tried this active learning in my class, it's not working for that reason, can you tell me how to make it work? So it makes us also feel that, yeah, you know, a lot of progress is being made. So it took us 5 years to get here. So somebody who had not heard of active learning has heard of it, has learnt it enough, implemented it in their class, and now in today's FDP, they are coming back to ask me questions that, hey, look, give me some more idea about how to make it more effective. So we have made progress, and in another 5 years, maybe the others who are listening to it for the first time, they will also get to that stage. So which is why this community building effort is very important, because if it is just you in your college who is trying it, you know, it's going to be an uphill task. It's never going to be easy. But then when there are so many people across the country who are trying it, you know, even if it's not in your own college, you can point to somebody and that's how it goes. So we will wait for another 5 years to see how much difference it's making.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for the detailed answer.
Okay, so we'll go on to RC1146.
Sir, this is Saranand from Knowledge Institute of Technology. Actually, in our college, we are doing a lot of active learning mechanism, like make a product, frontier area awareness, and 1 minute per technology presentation, like that we are doing. And really, that is it provides a very good platform to our students. They were actively participating in all contests which was hosted by premier institute like IIT Bombay, Niendra, as well as multinational companies like TCS, CodeVita. And sir, here my question is, we are doing lot of activities, we are recording, and if you want to upload those content in YouTube, how to create a common that in the license? So that is the thing, sir.
Okay, so the question is, we are creating a lot of useful activities and you want to upload a video into YouTube. How do you create your own Creative Commons license? So what you can do is, you don't have to do much. So there is a Creative Commons website. If you just Google Creative Commons, you know, creativecommons.org, and there are a set of questions, simple questions that you can answer, you know, how much distribution do you want and so on. And then it will generate one license for you. So all you have to do is you have to copy paste that license into your video. You can just put it on the first slide or, you know, at the end again, and that much is enough. See, the whole point is that when we are releasing something in Creative Commons and just attribution, we are actually letting people use that for whatever purpose that they want, and as teachers, that's our goal. I mean, we are not here to make money. So it may happen that some people will not use it the way you are intending it to be used, but that is okay. So as long as you want to release it into Creative Commons, all you have to do is go to the website, identify what should be the correct license that I use. That also the website will help you with asking questions about it. And then you just use that license, you just put it at the bottom of your first slide in the video, and that's all that we do. I mean, we also don't do anything more than that. If somebody violates it and so on, then there's nothing we can do. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, one more question.
Yes, please go ahead.
Good morning, sir. I am Sendil Kumar from Knowledge Institute of Technology. So in my theory session, I am using a special mobile app that is Flickr, that is for assessment. After conducting every unit, I am using that mobile app to conduct the assessment. And by using that tool, I am able to know whether all my students are understanding the concept fully or not. If it is not, if I am getting the score below 80%, then I am able to repeat that particular session. So if everyone use that tool, then we can conduct the theory sessions in a better way. Then if it is for a lab session, then I am using Google Forms to conduct the assessment. So if it is a regular Viva session, then the problem is students are familiar with the regular question. But in the case of Google quizzes, then we can conduct the same Viva in a more effective way, sir. So these are the two active learning practices I am following in my theory as well as lab sessions, sir.
Okay. So yeah, thanks for sharing this experience. So like I was saying for the previous question, you know, that what is the improvement that has happened? So we are seeing people who are already implementing this. And now it's a good thing that you are sharing what you are doing. What I would recommend is that instead of only sharing it during this live interaction session, you also write up a little bit about it, you know, write one page. Suppose, like, for example, somebody else in this hall has heard what you are saying and they want to do that for their course. So you just write up saying, okay, this is what I have done, this is the tool that I've downloaded, this is the instruction that you have to give to your students so that they can download the same app, this is how what I did in my class, this is how it worked for me. And then once we have a few of these experience reports, then maybe five of you together carry out a study and then maybe write a paper for T4E next year. So this will be a good next step for you to take. Okay, we can go to Tyagarajar College, 1173.
We do use active learning strategies in our classroom. My question is, we'd like to know few methodologies that would be used to evaluate the effectiveness of these methods that we use in the classroom.
Very good question. So how do you evaluate the effectiveness of active learning methods in the classroom? Okay, one way to not evaluate it is by giving the same standard question paper, right? Because what happens is, like, this is often the very big problem when you are carrying out studies and you are trying to write up research about that technique. Because what happens is that all these things that we do, active learning and all, is to deepen students' learning. And if you use the same exam at the end, which the students can mug up and come and write the answer, then there will be no difference seen in those exam scores, not significant. I mean, there will be a difference, your students will still do a little better, but they won't do so much better in such exams. So that exam is not your metric to use. So actually, so there are several other metrics that you can use. Okay. So one of them is, for example, you can use metrics which are dealing with the affective state of the student. Okay. So there are questionnaires which can measure how much the student's motivation for that subject has increased, how much the student's interest in that subject has increased from before you used the technique to now after you have used the technique. Okay, so learning is only one of the things that you will measure as an improvement because of your technique. Other things that you can measure are, you know, how much engagement has increased. Like, for example, in one of the times when I was teaching CS101, so many of my PhD students were sitting in the audience as observers. So during the think pair share, they were observing the other students to see, okay, how much engagement are they showing. So finally we wrote that up as a paper saying that, okay, when you use TPS in a classroom in this way, I mean, this was a very large class, 450 students classroom, and we found that, like, we can say 83% engagement was there in the classroom. So 83% of the class is engaged even though the class size was very large. So engagement is one thing you can measure, motivation, you can measure confidence. So many times students say that, oh, initially I used to feel that this subject I will not be able to learn, but now I feel confident that I can take up, I can do this thing well. So those things you can measure. And then you can also measure application, but then you have to change the question paper. You cannot give the same standard question paper that was being given earlier. I mean, in many universities that constraint is there that you don't control the question paper. Right? I mean, you control only the teaching that happens in your classroom. Somebody else has set the question paper. If that somebody else is not well versed with setting application level questions, you may find a question paper which is largely recall based questions. So you can do that. You can see how well the students are doing on projects. So these are some other metrics that you can use to evaluate the effectiveness. So by and large, so there are two reasons for doing that. One is for your own, you know, feeling that, yes, something is happening in my class, right? My students are learning. I mean, as teachers, that's our main goal, right? We want to get that feeling that, yes, my students are learning. So that will be satisfied. And the other one is to share that knowledge of, you know, how much it is increasing. That also will be satisfied. Using that to convince others to also adopt your techniques is a little more difficult. That will take it a little bit more time, you know, only after a lot of us have tried these activities and, you know, it becomes very common. Even this term active learning, if you think about 5 years ago, very few people had heard the term. Okay, so when we started doing these T10KT project and these MOOCs and all, that's when now people are casually talking about, oh, I do active learning in my class in this way. So we have made so much progress. So that's how the measurements will become useful.
I have an added question to this. We are aware of pre-test, post-test difference in scores and feedback questionnaire as data collection tools for measuring the effectiveness. Are there any other tool other than this?
So there are many other ways. So that is what I mentioned earlier, that this research methods in education technology, so we will be running this MOOC starting January. Okay. So right now we have already run it once in the T10KT model. So all the videos and all are there, but we have not put them in a MOOC format yet. So you can go to the T10KT website, IIT Bombay, and look for workshops and look for the research method, RMET, it's called Research Methods in Education Technology Workshop. So there we are talking about it. So that's the long answer. The short answer is that yes, there are many other ways. So one way is like to do what are called focus group interviews. So you take a group of students and you conduct an interview. So there is a protocol that can be followed for these focus group interviews, where the students express how much they have learned, how useful they have found that technique. So it's a little broader than using these survey instruments, because the survey instruments are allowing the student to only answer very specific questions. So in the focus group interviews, you know, you can get richer data, and then you do some kind of a content analysis of what they are saying. That's one way. Or what you can do is you can observe what they are doing in the class. Like if you have given them an activity, what exactly are they doing in the pair phase, and then you can see, is there any improvement in the kind of ideas they are exchanging with each other. So there are standard protocols for analyzing such data. So the data need not be only exam marks or their responses to your feedback questionnaires. The data can be quantitative data in terms of interviews, in terms of observations, and each type of data has its own corresponding analysis method by which you can draw inferences. Okay, so we'll take a rotation and we'll come to RC 1005.
You talk about publishing these results and educational technology journals.
Yeah.
How large the control group should be and how large there are metrics on that?
Okay. So the question is that you talked about publishing it and how large should be the control group and so on. So again, it depends. So now if you are going to do a statistical analysis, if you want to do something in that manner, then you do need a significant control group. I mean, there is no definition for significant, but people generally, as a rule of thumb, they say, anything more than 30, there is some statistical significance. Okay, anything less than that, it's very difficult to generalize these results. Like many of these statistical techniques, their results are not valid if the numbers are smaller than that. But that is if you are doing these control experimental type of studies. But before that, what you can do is, even if you have only 5 students, you can do these qualitative studies. So it's not necessary that you must do a quantitative study as your first study. Okay, so you can do a qualitative study where you are just seeing, okay, what are these 5 students doing? How is it making a difference to them? And the important thing to do is to follow a methodology. So there are several qualitative research methodologies, and you follow one of those methodologies to analyze the data. So you identify what is the type of data I need to, what is the question that I want to answer? For that question, what is the suitable data that I need to collect? And for that data, what is the suitable analysis technique that I should use? So once you know the answer to these three, you can even work with small numbers of students. Yeah, there is one more question.
Sir, it
doesn't matter.
In academic institutions, there are really lack of importance to publish data.
Okay. Okay.
So people are really teaching that they may not be a researcher, but the end, the people who are publishing more number of papers, they will be rewarded. And those who are doing book teaching, they are mostly suffered. And as far as research publications are concerned, the person who is doing the research, they can write the research paper, they will publish it. But the student of the teacher, they will do the research and they will publish the paper. Or the teacher of that person, he will do the research and he will publish the paper. Or somebody else, apart from these people, they will write papers and publish it. So how do you measure the merit of a person based on the publication?
Okay, so this question is a very broad question. How much importance to give to publication? See, this is a very standard problem. Okay, we have that in IITs also. Okay, a lot of us do this, but finally when it comes for promotion and all, it is like, okay, how many journal papers you are published? So that question is, it's there even in, it's not just in IITs, you know, you go to any university, you know, you go to MIT, everywhere. So while there is a lot of importance to research, the thing that we have to keep in mind is that what we are trying to create here, I mean, so this is the problem to some extent we are trying to solve through this education technology mechanism. Okay, like earlier you were just doing good teaching. Okay, now what we are saying is, look, it does not make sense for you to do, let's say, communication research. Okay, maybe your colleagues are doing communication research, maybe they are publishing, maybe it's useful, maybe it's not useful, maybe you don't have the resources, whatever be the reason, but it is important for you also to publish. So we are saying, okay, you can do education technology research. If your interest is more in education, then you can do research in that discipline. I mean, it's not necessary that you have to do research in your own, whatever subject that you are teaching. You can do education technology research. That way it becomes a little more meaningful, where you are getting some benefit for the good teaching that you are doing. But other than, you know, all these other questions that you asked about, you know, who's doing the research, where am I getting it done, you know, that is beyond my scope to answer, you know, I mean, so that's up to individual institutes. Yeah, I'm aware that, okay, this problem exists, but I don't have a solution for that. Okay, yeah.
Faculty get to spend time in research institutes for the research in that domain.
Okay, so the question, this again is an important question. Can we get time to spend time at IIT Bombay, ET department to further these research goals? The intended answer is yes. So there is a will to do that. So the implementation is a little tricky because, like even in this course, there are 5,000 people. Even if I take 1% of that, okay, we are still at 50. I certainly cannot accommodate 50 people. I can probably accommodate 5. Okay. Now, which 5, when 5, all those issues have to be sorted out. And we are still not yet, how do we rotate? Maybe by rotation, we can do that. So we are still working out that model, you know. So like I mentioned, one of the bullets was that working group bullet. So through that working group, maybe we'll say that, okay, we have created this working group, 5 people from one topic will come to IIT Bombay for, let's say, a week, you know, work together to create a set of resources on a particular course, on a particular topic, and then maybe also write up about that and then go back. So we are trying to make that happen. You know, there are a lot of other constraints, logistics issues are there, you know, there's accommodation issues are there. So we still don't have a good solution yet, but we hope that next year we'll have some mechanism by which, some of you can come to IIT Bombay turn by turn to participate in these working groups. Okay, so we'll go to RC 1343.
In active learning, there were two different strategies that were pointed out. One is think-pair-share and another is peer instruction strategy. But I could not find much difference between the two. Is there any major difference between TPS and PI strategies apart from just polling which happens in PI?
Okay, so the PI strategy is often driven by a multiple choice question. Okay, so you have different options and students choose an option and then they discuss with each other. So while both the strategies can be used, you know, it depends upon which strategy you find more suitable for that particular topic. PI generally we use when we want to either know what is the prior learning level of the students. Like for example, I'm going to start a topic and I want to see whether what is the level at which students already are. So I can have a set of PI questions and I can see that whether are they able to follow that, or I can do it in the end of the course where I say, okay, how much learning has actually happened. So often when you have questions which have specific answers, which can be put in a multiple choice format, then PI is a good strategy. Think pair share, on the other hand, is more useful when you have broader goals. Like if you want students to design a program, if you want them to come up with the idea of, let's say, building some software. So there, instead of just giving it as a project, group project, what you can do is you can split it up into a think phase, a pair phase, do this, then a share phase, and so on. So where there are multiple solutions that are possible, you want students to do some create level activity where you want them to apply what they are learning, there TPS is more suitable. Where you want to, you know, check their comprehension, you want to check whether they have understood the topic and you can use an MCQ format, there PI is more suitable.
So can we do polling in TPS? Is that will be okay?
There's no notion of polling in TPS because you have a you know, set of people. So after the pair phase, what you have is everybody is going to share the idea. So there's no question of a often when you construct a TPS activity, there's no single correct answer. It's like, for example, one very common activity that I use in CS101 is like sorting algorithms. Okay, so in the think phase, you say, okay, suppose you are given a set of 10 numbers, how are you going to sort them? Everybody knows some sorting or the other, they'll say, I will do it this way. Then in the pair phase, you have, you know, two people talk to each other, try to identify whose sorting technique works better, and so on. And in the share phase, together we come up with a set of sorting algorithms. So there is no polling, notion of polling when we are using TPS.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. We can go to RC1131, Walchand Institute of Technology.
Right now, there is no just such query, but I want to comment on the few things that questions that you have asked. So right from RMIT, we are practicing education technology, and also we have published three papers in T4E 2013. So we have started with TPS, peer review, visualization, and different techniques. And officially, we have established professional learning community locally at our institute, where we have organized structure, and through that structure, we are practicing ET and having some research in ET. So all the courses, that MOOC courses and the pedagogy courses or all the FDPs, are conducted locally in organized manner, and so that we can have a success in ET also and in completing the courses also. So this was the few things from our side. The one question is that now practicing the active learning is happening in the classes, but what next further research or the deep level research in this education technology?
Okay, so what I will say from Walchand Institute of Technology, to take us through the process, what did you do in the beginning? How did you go about setting up these things? So that if there are other RCs who want to, you know, do a similar thing in their college, they have some process that they can follow. And then I will come back and talk about, you know, how you can do deeper research. So over to you, Walchand Institute.
Thank you, sir. Sir, initially, as you said, we have started our practice in January 2013, and till July we have practiced the things, and then under the guidance of IIT Bombay, we did three papers in T4E 2013. Then we have individually started practicing this TPS, peer review, visualization, different techniques in the different classes by some practitioners. And then what we did is that we have established professional learning community. So structure of this community is like this. So at the apex, there's the principal, sir. After that, there is one PLC coordinator for the institute. And then we have departmental coordinators. Those are having some knowledge of ET, and they are guiding the practitioners from the department so that domain specific knowledge can be given to the different faculty members and they can practice the active learning. So this is one scenario for practicing the ET or having the active learning in the classes. For the others, like courses that conducted by IIT Bombay regarding this ET, so these departmental coordinators take care of all the faculty members. For example, there is some resource creation. We do peer review of that resources here locally before submitting this, so that we can have the more enhancement in this resource creation. One more thing is that we have started creating our videos also for flipped classroom. So we have set some guidelines how to create, what should be the format of that particular video with the under the guidance of the same that you have created, and then we are creating our own videos which will be circulated to the students and implementing flipped classroom. So we are setting some guidelines through this PLC which will be circulated to the mentors, and mentors will be following to the next faculty member. So this is a structure that we are following.
Okay, so very good, thank you. And what I would recommend is, you know, you again write up these guidelines that you are talking about and make it available as one of the OERs, and so that if any other you know, college wants to start, they don't have to reinvent the wheel, they don't have to start with, you know, discovering the mistakes that everybody makes in the beginning. So you can do that. And what we will try to do is, you know, the next T4E we will try to create a session where which need not be a research session, which can be a practice sharing session where many such colleges can come and say that, look, these are the practices that we have started adopting in our college, and this is the way in which we went through that. So some kind of session we will create. Now coming to your question of how can you do deeper research. So once you have done the first level of, you know, effectiveness in my own classroom, so there are multiple ways you can go. So one way you can go is what is called discipline based education research. So which is like, let's say you're teaching a subject. Now how to teach that subject more effectively? So there are communities which talk about that. Like, for example, the most famous one is the PER community, which is the physics education research community. So that was one of the earliest education research community. So they talk about, you know, should this topic be taught in this manner? Should it be taught in that manner? Should the topic be taught at all? And you know, what are the student misconceptions that arise in this topic? They talk about creation of concept inventories. A concept inventory is a set of questions using which you can identify the misconceptions that may be there for the student in that level. So PER community was one of the oldest communities. Then there is chemistry education research, there is maths education research, computer science education research is about 10 years old, 10 maybe 20 maximum 20 years old. And then we have also other disciplines, like there is a broad engineering education research also. So participating in these discipline based education research activities is one next level that you can take. And then the other next level that you can take is like what I had mentioned at the beginning, that participating in a project like our thinking skills project. So now we want to, let's say you are teaching a course like, for example, signals and systems. Now we also know maybe 50% of our students are not going to do that topic later on. No, they are going to do something else. But then you can ask yourself the question that what are these thinking skills that the student can learn through signals and systems, which will be useful for them even if they go into a financial services company. And then you can teach the topic from that angle. So then what happens is that the topic merely becomes an excuse for teaching them those thinking skills. And for different topics, they are amenable to different things. You know, many of these topics, and we need to go beyond ideas like, you know, mathematics or problem solving or something. So like, for example, in networking, one big emphasis that I have is on doing pros and cons analysis. You know, when you are doing different technologies, you're doing a pros and cons analysis of different technologies. So I take that as an excuse to teach how to do pros and cons analysis properly, rather than just the technologies of, you know, there is Wi-Fi, there is WiMAX, there is this, there is that, and so on and so forth. So those are some ways in which you can go further beyond doing action research. So what we are talking about right now is what is called action research. Beyond action research, you can do discipline based education research, and beyond discipline based education research, you can do this, you know, pan domain thinking skills education technology research. So these are possibilities that we can keep following. Okay, so we'll go to RC 1015, Vidya Pratishthan College.
Actually, my question is there that there are different techniques, but each technique is not matching for all the students. Means the mob of the student, actually, I'm talking about. That one technique may be suitable and effective for one class, but it may not be effective for the other class. So how to identify that which technique will be suitable for which people?
One technique won't be suitable for all the students, and how to identify which technique is suitable for which students? It's not possible to answer this at a very broad level, but see, by and large, you are best suited to answer this question because you know your students, right? I mean, I do not know your students. So in your college, if you feel that, look, my students will respond better to, you know, giving them tasks where they have to do something, you should use more techniques which are like that. Or on the other hand, if you feel that, okay, my students will respond better to peer instruction, PI questions type of technique, then you should use more techniques like that. Within the same class, it is very difficult to use different techniques for different students. But what you can do is, you know, you can make some options available, like in the case of assignment. So what we do is, like, for one assignment, we actually give some choices. We say that, okay, for assignment one, you can either do this or you can do that or you can do that. Like even in the FDP, we are saying, okay, you do it for your domain. We are not saying that this is the one assignment which everybody must do. So some such technique you can use to make sure that the needs of different students are met. But by and large, the only solution here is for you to become aware of number of techniques. Try out these techniques, find out what is working for you, and then you are the best person to decide what works for your class. I mean, I am not the best person to decide what will work for your class. Okay, so we'll go to RC1228.
So today morning you mentioned on different levels of teaching, and this lessons also which is focusing on the Bloom's taxonomy. Since we are the affiliated institution, we have to follow the university prescribed syllabus under their evaluation. We found that the different levels of teaching, Bloom's taxonomy, somewhat which is deviated from the university pattern of evaluation. How we can overcome such a problem, sir?
Okay, so there are two different things. See, what we discussed today was different levels of teacher practice. Like, even though it looks similar to Bloom's taxonomy, so Bloom's taxonomy is for levels of student learning. Okay, so that has the recall, understand, apply, analyze, create, those levels. Whereas here we are talking about, you know, teaching as you were taught, teaching using accepted practices, doing assessment, and, you know, finally doing some research and so on. So they are two slightly different things, but I get your question that if we are going to teach our students using these new techniques where we are taking them to higher levels of Bloom's taxonomy, like they are doing a lot of analyze activity, and if the exam is only going to focus on the recall level, what happens? So what is required is for, you know, many of you who have used these techniques for a long time, you have to get into these paper setting committees. There is really no other way. If the paper setting is still being done by people who have no exposure to active learning, you will continue to have those kind of questions only. So that seems to be the only way in which this problem can be solved. And like I said, education problems cannot be solved in a year. They have to be solved in a decade. So maybe in a decade, a large number of you who have undergone such active learning techniques and who are practicing it in your own colleges will slowly get to those positions where you can influence these setting of papers across colleges and so on. There is really no other solution to that.
So thank you, sir. I have one more question. I think last 2 months we are attending that FDP 1 and 2. What is your plan for next phase, then blended teaching in the phase 2? Is there any plan for the phase 3 like that in such FDP, sir?
Okay, so yeah, we have further MOOCs planned. Now it depends upon how much we will be able to execute. The plans are there, so we'll have to see. So for example, November we are thinking that we will start a MOOC on how to create a MOOC. January we will start a MOOC on how to do research using education technology. So we'll see, you know, how much we are able to do. We cannot sacrifice all, right? Neither you nor I can sacrifice all our subjects. See how much we are able to do.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we'll go to 135.
Sir, my question is, how to find the license of YouTube video?
So if there is no license stated in the video, there is no other way to find it out. I mean, you just have to see if you can get in touch with the creator and ask that person. It is the creator's responsibility to put the license.
Can we assume that all YouTube videos are Creative Commons licensed?
No. So we cannot make any such broad assumption. So somebody in this RC knows a better answer than I do.
In YouTube, if you go for the search tools, you have an option for CC license videos and standard YouTube license videos. So you can select the videos which are based on CC license.
Okay.
Creative Commons license are there, but it doesn't mean that they would have kept the photo of the Creative Commons license, or the statement may not be there inside the video.
Okay. Okay, so YouTube, you have to do a filter based on CC license, and that keeps you safe. So, okay, let's go to RC1282. This is our last request.
Good morning. I have a doubt on Think and Tash. How it can be applied for derivation based subjects?
Okay, so question is, how can we apply Think, Pair, Share for derivation based subjects? So, I mean, we will need a more specific example. At the broad level, it can be applied in the sense that what you can do is you can do a partial derivation yourself, and you can ask students to think about what will be the next step in the derivation. And then you can ask students to work in the pair phase to do the next few steps of the derivation before you come back and do the entire derivation in the classroom yourself. So that actually ensures that the students are thinking along with you and not simply following the derivation that you are doing on the board. So it depends upon the subject, of course, but by and large this technique can be used. I mean, you do some initial, start the derivation off, pause it at some point, ask students to do the next few steps, ask them to discuss about what should be the next step of the derivation, and then you can go ahead from there. So that is often a useful way of making bringing active learning into highly mathematical and derivation based topics. Okay, so
sir, another question, sir. How it can be applied for laboratories?
Yeah, so the question is, how can these techniques be applied in laboratories? So it's not necessary that you have to apply peer instruction and think, pair, share in a laboratory setting. You can use other active learning techniques, like you can have a team, pair, solo type of a technique which works for a laboratory setting. It depends upon, again, what you are doing in your laboratory. And as long as you are making students go beyond, following the lab manual and, aim, materials, procedure and so on, as long as students are doing beyond following routine procedure, whatever activity you do will be beneficial. So it doesn't necessarily have to be structured as a peer instruction or a TPS activity for a lab session. Okay, so there's a question which says, what is major contributor in TPS activity for its effectiveness? This is actually a very good question. So that is again some deeper research has to be done as to, like, why does TPS work? We know that it's working. Why does it work? Beyond saying that, okay, students are able to elicit their thinking, making them work in groups and so on. So the answer to this actually connects back to a previous question about, what is the deeper research that we can do. So there are techniques. So this goes into the domain of learning sciences and then cognitive sciences to find out why do these techniques work. I don't have a clear answer myself. I just know that it works. I have some broad ideas about why it works. But there's a lot of research left to be done as to why does collaboration work in this manner, when exactly does it work, what happens, what is the mental schemas that are set up for students when they are doing these activities. So there, at the state of the art itself is that people don't know these answers very well. Even the most leading researchers don't have very clear answers to why do these techniques work. So that is where we need large number of people to collaborate to try to determine answers to such questions. There was one question here. Yeah, so we'll take that as the last question. The local RC has priority. So we'll take the last question from the local. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, sir. For the past 10 years, I'm taking a FDP slider from Mission 10X, IIT, teachers training. And then the problem in implementing, so one of the deputy members mentioned that those they are doing for only certificate. Why? Because session also clearly mentioned, I don't know the evaluation seats. Clearly you are saying, but in teachers, in applications, cannot say this is not my administrative work. I am only for teaching. Hope you can understand, we are doing with 8 leisure work in classes. So that we cannot not put much concentration on teaching learning process. Rather than we are doing sort of proctor role, MBA role, admission mark calculations, etc.
Yes.
So that it was the best problem. When you are giving knowledge to the teachers, there is a run go to 5,000 teachers or every teacher. But in level of implementing, do you have anything associated with AICT? So that it will be going the proper way. We are ready to implement.
Okay, so the question is that, okay, how do we implement this when there is so many other tasks that we have to do? And it's a very valid point. So at the very least, people have reached up to awareness, right? Everybody knows the words active learning now. Some people are trying it out in their classrooms. That is one level. So, you know, the problem has to be tackled both bottom up as well as top down. Okay, so we started by tackling it in a bottom up fashion, saying that, okay, let's educate the teachers about these new methods and how to teach with technology and all that. Now we are also tackling it top down. Like Professor Fatak in the next session will be in a better position to answer. Like for example, this FDP is recognized by AICT. So we are attempting to also tackle it top down by saying that we will try to maybe, you know, have some mechanisms by which implementing these techniques gives you more credit than simply leaving it to your own initiative and things like that.
And moreover, sir, we put on one more addition to our site, because it is a survey document for us.
Okay.
Because it is mandatory for us to do best thing in our classes. But why all people, everybody, any teacher you ask, they want to do good to the students, but it is not included.
Yeah.
So that it is somewhere problem is also there. Apart from knowledge of teacher, apart from meaning of teachers.
Yeah, so this problem exists everywhere. I mean, it's not like it exists only in your college. It exists for me also.
For
okay,
all
I mean.
But so far, 10 years I'm going from the internet, I started 2007.
Yeah.
So many methodologies. But it wouldn't happen in the class because all the time it cannot go. 6 subjects are there.
Yeah.
So if all the teachers are giving video to previous day, then students will be taking it in a normal way.
That's true. So again, so this is the point is that, you know, you don't want to only do these things. This is like similar to the question that how many times do I do TPS? Do I do only TPS in my class? That's not so. See, the point is that when you're just lecturing, the efficiency is at most 0.2, 0.3, right? I mean, the learning gain slide that we have seen, this at most 0.3. Now you do a little bit of TPS here and there, it goes up to 0.5, you know, if you do it well, it goes up to 0.7. So that is all that we are attempting to do. We are not saying that everybody must do it every lecture in this manner. That's not what we are saying. And so do as much as you can, as much as is meaningful for your students, and think about, okay, for this topic, does it make sense? So it's not like lecturing is bad. There is a time for telling. So we just want to ensure that we do the telling at the appropriate time. That's all. Right? So that, and this other question of, you know, teachers' motivation, yes, there is a lot of work. Like, for example, take my case. You know, even all of us at IIT Bombay who are doing these FDPs, it is all counted as part of our outreach or service activities. It does not count for us, for any other, you know, the same metrics that you are talking about, that, okay, for promotion, I need to show this, I need to show that, I need to show that. Same thing applies to us. You know, we get no marks for doing this. Still, we are here on Sundays doing this. Why are we doing this? Same thing for you also. You are doing it because you believe in doing it. You believe, and there is a philosophical component to it. You are consciously making a choice that, okay, it is okay if I don't get that promotion. It's okay if that does not happen. Doesn't matter. Okay. This makes sense to me. I'm going to do this. So you have made a choice and you are leading your life as per those choices that you are making. And whatever compromises you have to make as a result of making the choice, you say, okay, I will make that compromise. So it happens. Yeah. Okay. So we'll stop here. Okay. So thank you for being with me for this session.